regreso aquí en Auto 060. Muy interesante toda esa información que nos estaban dando sobre el cambio de aceite en el auto, las precauciones que hay que tener. Y ahora vamos a hablar a un tema que yo creo que nos interesa a todos. Estamos viendo cómo la industria china de los autos está avanzando a gran velocidad. Primero con la compra de vehículos en China, que es realmente espectacular. La misma General Motors, por ejemplo, el Buick, que es uno de los autos más vendidos en China. Y los autos de lujo ni se digan, no dan abasto los fabricantes de Bentley, de Ferrari, de Lamborghini, de Maserati. Así que vamos a hablar con nuestra colega Christy Schweinsberg de WordsAuto.com, quien estuvo recientemente en China en una conferencia y nos va a dar sus impresiones sobre lo que está pasando y lo que va a pasar con el mercado del auto chino. So we're switching now to English to listen about the Chinese auto industry with Christy Schweinsberg from WordsAutos.com. Christy, thank you very much. Christy from WordsAutos.com. Thank you very much for taking the time and talking about your recent trip to China.
Thank you, Javier, for having me. I appreciate it.
A very interesting headline, as always, a very catchy headline. China still 5 to 10 years away from being a Western player. It's a very interesting place, I guess. I've never been, so can you give me your first impressions of that?
Well, I was in Wuhan, which is a city basically in the center of China, and it's considered a small city in China, although it has 10 million people. my first impression was that it was definitely different than the U.S. They have modern structures, but they're not quite as advanced in their building techniques as we are here in the U.S. in terms of, high rises and roads. The road we came in on from the airport was very rough, and it was undulating. And so they in Wuhan anyway, they've got a bit of ways to go to match the standards of, American building and construction. But everybody I met was very nice, and I stayed at a Western hotel. I stayed at a Renaissance, which is a Marriott brand in Wuhan, and went to this conference, Global Automotive Forum. It was the fourth time the conference has been held, and they wanted to have Western media this time. So they contacted a gentleman they know in Detroit, and he they asked him who would be good to invite to the conference, and they invited myself, and they also invited the crew of Autoline Detroit, John McElroy, and his producers. And some other people, Reuters, Bloomberg was there, New York Times was there. So we gathered together to learn more about the Chinese auto industry.
Yeah, and this impression that they are 5 to 10 years away, it's based on the quality of the product, the technology, the engineering. What is it? I mean, they're already in some countries, in South America. I don't know if in Europe, I don't think so, but they're already exporting cars. So why is this impression that they're still that long time away from being a major player?
Well, mainly what I'm speaking about in the story is markets that have barriers to entry, such as, fuel economy regulations, emissions regulations, and safety regulations. So you can't sell in Europe or the U.S. unless you meet, NHTSA, EPA regs, NCAP in Europe regs. So in that respect, they're 5 to 10 years away from creating a vehicle that is able to be sold in those markets that has the type of technology that is required by the governments in the U.S. and Europe.
And also, to make it profitable for them, right? Because I remember when Tata announced, 5-7 years ago, that they were going to start making the $2,500 car, the Nano. And that car, was a big news. And I remember I asked Bob Lutz, who at the time was still with GM, and I asked him, when are we going to have that kind of car in the U.S.? And he said, he already have it. It's a Chevy Aveo, but it costs $12,000. So
right.
It's pretty much the same thing, right?
Yeah. The Chinese have low labor costs, but it still is going to cost them basically what it costs every other automaker to outfit their vehicles with the technology they need to meet the safety regulations and the emissions regulations and the fuel economy regulations. So once you do all that, once you create, you know, let's just say a small car like an Aveo, the price discrepancy between a Chinese branded small car and let's say a Japanese branded small car being sold in the U.S. is not going to be that great. You know, they're going to be almost as expensive as say, you know, a $10,000 Nissan Versa. So that's a concern. But really what the panelists were talking about and what I based my story on was that, you know, the Chinese right now to a Western consumer, to somebody in the United States, when you think of Chinese produced goods, not just automobiles, but anything made in China, you think of those goods as being cheap.
Yeah, they don't have a very good reputation yet. Yeah.
Right. And cheap is basically, it means poor quality, you know. So one of the panelists was talking about Bill Russo, who's a very well-known Chinese auto industry consultant, was that you need to change the brand image of your product. You know, he was speaking basically to Chinese domestic manufacturers, that they need to change the brand image of their product.
Country, no? Like you were talking about other products. I mean, they have to build the brand, the China brand in general.
Right. And it's been well reported that, you know, there still isn't a major brand that's come out of China that has taken hold in the West. You could say Lenovo, but that's, you know, against Samsung or Apple. Yeah. Lenovo is not really a very big brand.
Tough
competition. You know, where is China's Samsung? Where is China's Apple? You know, we've not seen it yet. And certainly we've not seen it in autos. Yes, the Chinese automakers are selling in other markets, but they're typically markets that don't have the barriers to entry that, you know, the major markets do, like the U.S. and Europe.
So in that sense, I mean, if we take a comparison with the Hyundai and Kia from South Korea, they've been already in the States for like more than two decades, but their reputation only has been built up in the past, what, 5-6 years? So it's probably longer than 5-10 years, no?
Yeah, 5-10 years may be ambitious. The one gentleman I quoted in the story, Bill Russo, was saying that for some automakers, they might be closer. He mentioned Great Wall, which is a automaker of like light trucks, SUVs, pickups, the type of vehicles that aren't really sold in the U.S. anymore, that are sort of just basic body on frame light trucks. He thinks they might have, you know, they might be able to come in 5 years, but others are going to take longer. And then there was another person on the panel, a Chinese executive that talked about, you know, there's a lot of paperwork involved in selling in other countries. There's a lot of negotiations. You've got to manage cultural differences. If you're going to sell in a foreign country, you probably should have employees that live in that foreign country. So how do you integrate those people with your Chinese management? You know, there's issues of technology sharing that can arise. It's a very complicated proposition.
Yeah.
And also, you know, the U.S. market isn't really growing very much. I mean, it's, you know, this year has been a pretty good year, but relative to the type of growth they've been seeing in China, you know, everybody, there aren't a lot of people that don't have a car that want a car.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
If anything, there's people that aren't driving, you know, the younger generation isn't driving as much as they used to. So,
exactly.
And the brands sold here are good brands, and they've got good quality
very
and
tough
they're reliable.
Very tough competition. So I guess for now we're going to keep seeing the quote-unquote journalists from China with cameras and tape measures under the cars at the auto shows, right?
Oh, yes. I mean, they certainly are studying the Western and the developed market manufacturers with very much vigor, and they, you know, they're in all these joint ventures with Western automakers in China, but the technology sharing is not really happening because, of course, you know, no company wants to give away their trade secrets. So the Chinese are still learning.
But they are investing heavily. I think they now own Volvo, right? So, I mean, they're making some progress, not with their own brands, but like as an industry. And maybe that's a first step.
Right. So acquisitions is one way for the Chinese domestic companies to gain a foothold in the West. And Geely is the owner of Volvo now. But you have to remember that Volvo technology in the vehicles now was developed by Ford. Eventually, Geely is going to have to, you know, create new platforms and new powertrains. And that's, you know, we'll have to see how they do. You're not going to be able to use the Ford technology forever, so they're going to have to go it alone pretty soon.
Yeah, Christy Schweinsberg from WordsAuto.com. Thank you very much again, as always, for your time. Very interesting, and our audience can go and look for more information about this in WordsAuto.com, right?
Yes, they can. I've got a story I'm just finishing up now, interview with the lead designer for Chery, which is a major Chinese domestic manufacturer. So that should be coming up later this week.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Christy, and see you soon at another auto event or maybe the auto show in L.A.
Of course, Javier. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye. Have a great day. Y ya regresamos aquí en Auto 060 con una historia de la chica que se enamoró del Mercedes-Benz CLA 2014.